gracious Heavenly Father, we come into thy glorious presence. Thou art the Holy One on high. O Lord, how can we approach thee? We thank thee we may come. In the name of Jesus Christ, the eternal Son, our Lord and Saviour, who came from heaven and earth to suffer and die on Calvary, to bear away the punishment of sin for all his own. O Lord, we thank thee for Jesus Christ the Lord, and we pray that thou wilt look upon us now, pardon and forgive us afresh all our sin, and by thy Spirit, by thy gracious Holy Spirit, work in every heart this night, all that we may render sincere worship, that we may grasp who thou art, the living God, sovereign over all, that we may love thee and seek after thee, that souls may come to feel their need of thee and desire thee and long for thee. Lord, so work in every heart this night, we ask, and bless each one. We ask these things in the name of our Saviour, for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing together the hymn number 207. Hymn number 207. Let us love and sing and wonder.
Thank you.
Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. For this shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Surely in the floods of great waters they shall not come nigh unto him. Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eye. Be ye not as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle, lest they come near unto thee. Many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he that trusteth in the Lord, mercy shall compass him about. Be glad in the Lord, and rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all ye that are upright in heart. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Let's sing together hymn number 32, version 3, based on that psalm. Hymn number 32, version 3. Blessed are they, supremely blessed, whose wickedness is all forgiven.
Thank you.
Matthew chapter 11. And we begin to read from verse 16 the words of Christ on the unreasonableness of human beings. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows and saying, we have piped unto you and ye have not danced, we have mourned unto you and ye have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he hath a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a wine bibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. Then began he to upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Woe unto thee, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at the day of judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which art exalted unto heaven, shalt be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. But I say unto you, that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. At that time Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father, neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Come unto me, all ye that labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. May God add his blessing to that further reading of his word and grant us all understanding.
We give a warm welcome to those who are visitors with us for this evening's service, and also to those who join us online webcast. And we pray that you will know the Lord's blessing as we hear the gospel of his grace. And the preacher is our pastor, Dr. Peter Masters. Audio and video recordings of recent ministry are available in the entrance vestibule. Today's ministry will be available after this evening service, and our magazine, Golden Trial, will also be obtained. During this week, our prayer meeting is on Monday evening at 7:30. Our Bible study is on Wednesday evening, when the preacher will be Pastor Ibrahim Mohammed, our assistant pastor. This service begins at 7:30 and is followed by a time of fellowship and refreshments, and we do encourage all to join with us on Wednesday evening to study God's word. Our services next Sunday will be at 11 in the morning and 6:30 in the evening, when the preacher, God willing, will be our pastor. At the close of this evening service, Dr. Masters and Pastor Ibrahim will be available in their vestries for any who would like to speak with them. And there's a special notice again this evening that we are continuing to collect names for the petition to Southwark Council about our parking needs here at the Tabernacle. And if you've not already signed, we do hope that this petition will receive your sympathetic support. Forms to add London-based names are available in the entrance vestibule and our church offices. And now the stewards will take up our offering for the Lord's work.
Salvation, and that thou dost come after us. and touch our lives and hearts, and cause us to fall before thee and seek thee. O Lord, wilt thou not do that wonderful work of love in hearts in this place tonight, that men and women, young and old, may seek thee and find thee, and possess thee and have thee, and all thy power and kindness and blessing enter into their lives. Lord, come down in our midst, we pray. Take away all our foolish prejudices. Take away all that pride and resistance. Take away all that determination to cling to the things we have and know in this failing life, this passing world. Oh Lord, we pray that thou wilt show us the great things of heaven and eternity, and draw us to Christ, that he may be glorified in saved lives and transformed lives, that he may do that wonderful work of grace in us. Lord, come and bless us tonight. Bless through the great feebleness of human preaching. Bless thy word, O Lord, by the power of the Spirit, that we may grasp and understand and see our need and come to Christ. Lord, bless us now and be with us. Be with thy people everywhere, throughout this city, this land, throughout the world, before the Lord's day shall close, wherever the gospel is lifted up and messengers of Calvary reach out to lost souls. O Lord, mightily bless and gather in the lost, thy elect, and save souls and bless lives, and look upon us also in this place. Hear our cries, O Lord, hear our prayers, hear an answer from on high, for we bring them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour, asking all for his dear sake. Amen.
Amen.
Sing together the hymn 373. Hymn number 373. Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee.
Thank you.
together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. And our title is Reasoning with God. Now we are, by nature, severed from God. We do not relate to Him, we do not know Him, we do not love Him, we do not particularly want Him. We are alienated creatures, separated from God. We are generally not interested in Him, indifferent to Him, and possibly even actively hostile to Him. And yet these words come. Come now and let us reason together. It is God who breaks the silence. It is God who speaks. And first of all, I'd like to think for a few moments of this extraordinary appeal by God to human souls. It's a remarkable call. The injured party appeals to the injurers. The one who has been wronged, Almighty God, the one who is our Creator, the one who is insulted and despised and set aside by us and treated with indifference and not worshipped and not thanked and not loved and not served and not studied and not inquired after, the one who made all, the perfect God on high, the injured party, appeals to us. Come now and let us reason together. He's portrayed here in a calling mode, an appealing mode, remonstrating with us. It's a fatherly call, a kindly call, a call from the approachable God. Come now. You could insert a little word there, and it brings through the flavour of the original. Verse 18, come on now, you could say. It puts in the encouraging note, which is there in the Hebrew. The enticing, calling, appealing tone. It's there, come now, but come on now. What are you doing? Why are you ruining your life? Why are you walking away from me? Why are you wasting your years? Why are you closing your mind and your eyes to heaven and eternity and spiritual things? Come on now. Come. Let's break this absurdity, this foolishness. Come now. That's the tone. That's the flavour. Come now. And let us reason together. Literally, let us argue. Let us cross swords if necessary. What's your complaint about me? Says God. The condescension of God in the most kindly imaginable way. What's your problem with me? What reason do you have for not believing me? For not believing in me? For not being interested in me, for not being thankful for all that I've done and given to you. Come now, let's talk about this. But we're his enemies. What's he doing? Speaking in such a manner to those who have no time for him, those who very likely slandered him many times, those who used him even just as a profanity, as a swear word. What's he doing? Appealing in such a kindly way to us. Come now and let us argue together. I will give you my reasons, says God, why you should be mine. And you may offer me your reasons why you don't want to be mine. And then I shall respond to you and try to help you. Let's discuss this. Talk about this. Weigh this. Think about this. Come now. And let us reason together, said the Lord. You're getting nowhere in life.
You're just living for the here and now, for the things you can touch and possess and feel and hear and enjoy momentarily at shallow level. That's all you live for, and it's hard work, and there are countless disappointments, and you have no ultimate purpose or destiny in life, and no relationship with me. Wouldn't you like to talk about this with me and deal with it? Your life is asleep. Your soul is asleep. Time is going by. Other influences are getting hold of you. This world is getting its hooks and its clutches into you, so that it means everything to you. As years go by, you'll have less and less inclination, less and less desire to seek and find the Creator of all things, your God, your rightful Lord. You'll be further and further away. You'll be controlled and driven by so many faults and sins and problems. So much unbelief. Self-determination will take you over. You must have your own way. It'll get worse. This world will take you over. You'll be in its clutches, under its influence, following it, its passions. Think. Come and consider these things. Weigh them up. Come now and let us reason together, said the Lord. The kindness of God to approach us when we will not approach him. It is astonishing and amazing. Well, dear friends, I'd like to talk about these things for a while. God's appeal. Look at the very first, the second verse of chapter 1 here. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. In this appeal, this is perhaps the first point of God's reasoning. This is why you should be mine, he says. And this is why you should turn to me. Because I made you. You were rightfully mine. And I've provided for you. You breathe my air. You eat my food. I sustain you in every conceivable way. I've watched over you. I've made you special. I've made you so much higher than the animals. They do not have the power of reason, which I have given to you. They do not have the power of creativity, which I've given to you. They do not have the power of language, which I've given to you. They do not have anything like the same degree of intelligent, thoughtful, complex, conscious life, consciousness, that great special gift. They don't have an instinct for God. They don't have a moral consciousness. I've given you so much, and I've given you gifts and powers. Some of them are distinctive to you. Some of your aptitudes and your particular combination of aptitudes and powers and abilities and gifts are very likely largely unique to you. I've done so much for you. So the Lord begins with his reason. Come now, let's reason. Let's think about this. You are rightfully mine. I have designed you and made you. I have set you here. I have given you life for an ultimate spiritual purpose. You are mine. But look what you've done, he says in verse 3 of the chapter. You've lost your instincts for me, even. You've been so immersed in yourself and in the material things of life and in this world and in the things and entertainments and things you admire that the ox knoweth his owner and the ass his master's crib. Those poor dumb creatures instinctively know who it is who owns them and looks after them. But you've lost all instinct for your God. But Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. You don't recognize me, says God. You don't desire me. You have no appreciation. You think you have no need of me. You have dismissed me. You have declared me totally irrelevant to you. You do not consider, you do not think about it. The ox knoweth his owner, the ass his master's crib, but Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. You do not even think about it. So that's God's case, or at least that's the beginning of his case. That's how he proceeds. As a result, he says, you're in trouble. Here it is in verse 1, verse 2 rather. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. And then I go down to verse 4. Ah, sinful nation, listen to this. A people laden with iniquity, seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors, they have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger by their extreme indifference and ingratitude. They are gone away backward. And then the prophet says, speaking from God, verse 5, why should you be stricken anymore? The whole head is sick, the whole heart faints. From the sole of the foot, even unto the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. You're in all kinds of trouble because of this. Well, you have happy times. There are things you enjoy. There are comforts you possess in this world. There are many things, but also many disappointments and troubles and problems in the world and in your life, because you haven't got the help of God, because you're alienated from him. You don't know his comfort, you don't know his strength, you don't know his blessing, you don't know the new life that he gives. You lack these things. So this is the case of God. I made you, and I made you special. And I've given you everything, and I sustain you, and you're mine. And what's more, because you ignore me, I cannot bless you. So life, whatever you get out of it, is tinged with sorrows and difficulties. And you're going to grow old, and faint, and weak, and it's all going to seem so pointless. Why go through with that? If you were related to me, if you were reconciled with me, says the Lord, I would help you and bless you and fill you with all manner of things. So that's the case that God advances. How do we respond? That's the interesting thing. What are we going to say to him? Oh, I say to God, that's all very well. I'm intellectually unconvinced. I'm unconvinced that God is there. I'm unconvinced about the being of God. How do I know that he's there? Why can I not do just as I please and have God as well? And besides, why is there tragedy in the world? If there was a God, there wouldn't be. That's not fair. That's not right. This is our kind of response in the reasoning. God has made his case. This is our case by way of return. And why do so many people, if there is a God and there's heaven and there's hell, why do so many people suffer exclusion from heaven? That's not right. That's not fair. And so we begin to make our complaints. We haven't thought them through. The answer's actually obvious. To all the complaints that men and women make, old and young, about God, the answers are all in the Word of God. We could spend all evening going one by one through some of the problems and the objections. It wouldn't do a lot of good, because the trouble with us is as soon as we get an answer to one objection, we're scouting around for another. Our problem is that we don't really want to hear these answers. It's plain, logical, sound, and obvious in God's will. They're all different. God is so gracious and tender, he even goes to the length of answering our rude objections and complaints about him, our ill-informed complaints. And he helps us to be true to our instincts and to believe in him. But right here, in this passage, God doesn't tick off answers to those complaints. He comes first to a major point. The trouble with you, he says, is not that you're intellectually unconvinced. It's not a problem in your head. It's a problem in your heart. The problem is, we don't like this, but this is God's response here. The problem is not an intellectual one, but a moral one. You don't want me. You want just material things. You want to take me completely for granted. You want to take what I've given you and run off with it for yourself. You don't want me. You don't want any direction in your life. You don't want to repent of your sin. You don't want to seek my help. You just don't want me. That's the trouble. But we can come to all the complaints, but this is the thing that has to be dealt with first. It's there in verse 18. Look at it. Come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. And then the Lord moves straight in to the real issue. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. You've got to face up to your antagonism to God and want the answers to the questions. You've got to face up to the personal problem, dear friends. That's the way to find the Lord. That's the real problem. Oh, friends, there's so much to be said about the Lord and his kindness and his way of salvation. But if you don't seek him, and if you don't find him, let me tell you first some of the things you'll never have, and you'll never experience. You'll never know your potential as a person. Might seem a strange thing to say, but you won't. Because you're made to be a worshipper of God, and you're made to learn of him, and you're made to have his help, and you're made to serve him. You're made to discover him and rejoice in him and experience him. You're made to function and to operate at a spiritual level. And the trouble is you can't. Because your soul is asleep. It's dormant. Because you're cut off from him. It isn't functioning. You're only operating at the physical, purely human level. You can never know your potential. You can never know what you would be in the hand of God, and the life that he'd give you, and the happiness, and the depth of understanding of life and people, and the immense usefulness you'd have to all around you, and to your family, and to your children. You'll never know your full potential in the service and in the ownership of Almighty God, because you're cut off from him. And I must be quick, there's another thing. You'll never know acceptance by God, of course. You'll never know what we call justification, a tremendous word which comes out of the scriptures and was re-emphasized at the time of the Reformation, where God declares you accepted by him and just in his sight, not because you deserve to be, but because you put your trust in Jesus Christ, who suffered and died for sinners and gave up his perfect righteousness to be imputed to all who embrace him and come to him. And when you come to Christ and you repent of your sin and you yield your life to him and he takes you and changes you, that's what we call conversion. Simultaneously, there is a great declaration from God the Father in heaven which declares you just. God undertakes to deal with you as though you had never sinned and were wholly innocent before him. And God undertakes not only to regard you as clean, but also to reward you as though by your own righteousness you deserved all the blessings that he can give and eternal glory. Justification in the sight of God, the greatest thing that can happen to any living soul, and you'll never know it, never taste it. That declaration will never be made about you because you never sought and found Christ. You're alienated, cut off from him. And because you've never been saved, never been justified, if that's the tragedy with you, you will never have mastery over your sin. At the moment, the sin tendency and lusts and desires dominate you. We're ruled by our pride. There's that maggot of deceitfulness working in our minds and hearts all the time. We exaggerate, we lie, we make excuses, we justify ourselves. We are devious individuals. You'll never master these things without the help of God and the power of God. Sin will have mastery over you, but with God, you will have mastery over your sin, and your conquest of sin through your life will be blessed, and you will be progressively successful. Dear friends, you'll never have that experience. You'll never have answered prayer. The wonderful adventure of answered prayer right through life. You'll never have peace about death and victory over it and eternal life. You'll never know the strength and the guidance of God. You'll never know communion with him, what it is to have him and to walk with Christ and have his constant interventions in your life. You'll never have an explanation of mankind and human nature because you never understand the Bible. You'll never understand God's explanation. All these things you forfeit and you miss through alienation from God, and you have many sorrows and much heartache and no ultimate purpose. Dear friends, time is going on. Let me look at the second part of verse 18. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. This is the promise of God. As scarlet, the crimson dyes, made, we're using insects and oak, by the people of Tyre, the famous Tyre and Sidon. That was their craft, and they dyed the cloth over and over again until it was absolutely colour fast, and you couldn't remove it, you couldn't get rid of it, you couldn't shift it or wash it out. They were renowned for it. Though your sins be as scarlet. Why does the prophet, under inspiration, choose language like this? Because, you know, to each other, our sins may not be as scarlet. They may be very obvious, very glaring, very horrible, but mostly we hide the worst about ourselves and put on a front. But to God, everything is glaring. Though your sin be as scarlet, it's lurid and obvious, and it's permanent as a stain. You cannot cure it, you cannot wash it away. This is the charge of God against you. The trouble is your sin. It's conspicuous to God. Do you have a temper? Oh, dear friends, are you ruled by pride? Does the question constantly come up? Everything that happens to you, how will I appear? How will I be seen? How will this affect me and my status or position and what people think of me? You have great pride, boasting of things, putting yourself across, putting on a great show, trying to appear better than us. Do you lie? yourself. Oh, I wish I could stop these compulsive exaggerations and lies. But you can't. They go on and on. And selfishness. You're a selfish person. People don't like to admit to being selfish. You watch after number one. You put yourself first. You won't be helpful to others, husband or wife, if you can get away with staying in a chair and let the other do everything. You have this selfishness in you, running through your being. Can you be cruel and hurtful and lash out? Third, sins of deed, and then sins that are just our state of heart, what we are. We are proud and we are deceitful. It's our condition, as well as a series of events and actions. Sin, it's everywhere in us. We're defiled and we're cut off from God and we need His pardon. Red, scarlet, the colour of violent sin. Oh, dear friends, let me come to the Lord Jesus Christ. The amazing and the astonishing thing that Christ, who is God, equal with the Father, three persons in one Godhead, the Father, Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit of God, all equally divine and wonderful and powerful. They are one, and yet they are three. A great mystery to our poor, feeble human understanding. And Christ, we call him the second person of the triune Godhead. Christ came into this world and became a man, the God-man, in order to be our representative, in order to suffer and die for us, in order to go to Calvary's cross, where something so difficult to describe took place. Outwardly, he was nailed to a cross. There he hung in the sun, bleeding. He'd been scourged, whipped to the bone. Flesh open with running wounds. And he hung there. But it wasn't the physical pain. It was, of course, but that was almost nothing compared with the spiritual pain, with the pain in his soul, as the Father, in love, put upon him all the guilt of all that scarlet, lurking, glaring sin of all who would ever be forgiven in the history of the world, and punished him instead of us. They had agreed it. In the eternal glory, who will go, says the Father. I will go, said the Son. Whatever moved him to come and to suffer and to die in inexpressible agony, pain that cannot be measured, his saving love, his love for lost souls, his love for the people who would be saved, who would be his own for all eternity. In compassion he came, and he suffered in his soul the most terrible, terrible desolation and separation from the Father, and everything that we should have borne forever and forever and forever. You cannot understand this, impossibly compressed into the space of 6 hours. And he took it all for millions upon millions of people. Who can measure his love? Who can weigh his kindness? Impossible. That's what the Saviour came and did for lost souls, in order that we could be forgiven when we repent of all our sin, when we trust in him alone for new life and salvation. Come now, says the Lord, come on now. Let us reason, argue together, said the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, and they are, they shall be white as snow. What a picture. You you go to bed at night and the fields are green and the streets are just as normal. A couple of hours heavy snow and you get up in the morning and look out with astonishment. Everything is so pure and so clean and so white. The landscape is transformed. The ugly parts are now so beautiful. Everything is perfect and wonderful. What a picture. God forgives you, he forgives you entirely. Your sin, we say, is cast into the sea of God's everlasting forgetfulness. He will remember it no more against you. Because Christ has borne the punishment, the Father will look upon you as though you had never sinned, and will bless you and transform you, and you will be different. You will be changed as the landscape. That old nature, constantly for me, constantly boosting me, constantly looking out for my interests, now loves the Lord. And prays to him, and praises him, and seeks him, and works for him. Dear friends, the change in our nature and our whole disposition, the differences are so great. We are still sinners, fighting against that until our last breath. But oh, we are so changed. Here's the promise, and I close reading these words. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Do think this through and weigh this carefully. Come in repentance. The promises of God are so great that he will certainly receive you and forgive you. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. It's forgiveness we need. And then God will answer all our questions. And we shall understand. And we shall be at peace. Seek him, friends. Let's pray. Oh God, our gracious Heavenly Father, look upon us all this night and help us. Oh Lord, we pray that help so work in our hearts that we shall no longer be on the run against thee, putting up complaints and barricades, not wanting answers, but rather to escape. Oh Lord, move so in our hearts that we shall yearn for thee and long for thee and the forgiveness that comes with believing in Christ. Help us all, bless us now and profoundly change us so that we become thine. We ask these things in the name of our Saviour, for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Together the hymn number 403. Hymn number 403. Lord Jesus, full of truth and grace.
Saviour, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit rest and continue with each one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.